Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to today's Lunch Hour Lecture. I'm Jack Ashby from UCL Culture and here to welcome you and host today's talk. Very pleased to see all of you here, and I'm shortly going to introduce our lecturer, Colin Penman. But before I do, if there's anyone watching outside of this room, or indeed anyone in this room who wants to submit questions by electronically rather than at the end of the talk, then please use the Slido code 7105 on www.sli.do, and we'll come to your questions at the end of the talk. So today our lecturer is Colin Penman, who is head of records in UCL Archives, part of UCL Library Services. Prior to joining UCL about 8 years ago, Colin was also the records manager for the British Library. So in his time, he has managed a lot of records, and it perfectly places him to give today's talk, which is The Youth of Our Middling Rich, How Egalitarian Are UCL's Founders? If you join me in welcoming Colin Penman. Thank you.
Thank you, Jack, for that kind introduction. And I'd like to say also thank you to my colleagues in Library Services for really enabling me to undertake this research. And thank you for coming. On the 30th of April, 1827, a ceremony was held to mark the opening of UCL's new building, the laying of the foundation stone of the new, as it was called, London University. As part of the observances, Edward Maltby, who was preacher of Lincoln's Inn, offered a prayer. O Almighty Lord God, who art the author of all good, and without whose gracious aid no thought of man can prosper, we humbly beseech thee to regard with thine especial favour that undertaking in which we are now engaged, so that loyalty and peace, truth and justice, religion and piety may abound more and more to the promotion of thy glory and their own everlasting felicity. That's just the beginning and end, but you get the idea. There are a lot of myths about UCL. One of the most persistent is that UCL was founded by Jeremy Bentham. Here he is, in all his glory, receiving the plans for what's now the Wilkins building, our main building, from its architect William Wilkins, who kneels there before him like a supplicant. Quite a lot of people do regard Bentham as UCL's founder, and this picture both promotes and reflects that idea. But if we mean that UCL was Bentham's idea, and that he was the driving force and made it happen, it just isn't true. To return to that foundation stone prayer, from where we are now, almost 200 years later, this fervent praise of the Almighty, an appeal for his aid, might seem surprising to us, might seem a bit shocking even. After all, this is Thomas Arnold's godless institution, the radical infidel college, even in the words of Edward Irving, who admittedly was a bit of a nutter, quoting the book of Revelation, the synagogue of Satan. This is another UCL myth, but it's an important part of our self-image, I think. We are godless, egalitarian, progressive. Some of our students even wear t-shirts like this one. Nothing wrong with that. We were unique in our foundation, we like to believe, because we were the first English university established after Oxford and Cambridge, debatable, the first to admit students regardless of race, class, religion, or gender. And it's something UCL says, or used to say, quite a lot. An advertisement in the Times, for example, for the centenary appeal in 1925, tells us that UCL was the pioneer college in providing university education without any restrictions of class, creed, or race, and in opening university education to women. For a long time, this picture has formed how we think of this place and how we portray it to the world, and it was absolutely entrenched by the time of those centenary celebrations. But is it true? How did UCL stand out among its peers? Did it? Because if other universities accepted students regardless of race, class, religion, and gender, UCL suddenly isn't so special, is it? 1825, the year of what we might call UCL's conception, was a year that London overtook Peking to become the world's largest city, I think a sign of what was to come in terms of London and the British Empire's dominance of what we call the long 19th century. The defeat of Napoleon was only 10 years ago. The so-called Industrial Revolution was underway in at least parts of this kingdom. We're halfway through George IV's mercifully short reign. The Tory Earl of Liverpool had been Prime Minister for 13 years. His party was in power for 18 years, or actually since 1770, if you count a couple of, just leave out a couple of short interludes. Jews, Catholics, and dissenting Protestants, they were growing in numbers, but were subject to legal restrictions, which prevented them taking a full part in public life, and that included the benefits of a university education. Catholic emancipation was eventually forced through in 1829, so not very far away, and the Reform Act, which brought long overdue reforms to a corrupt electoral and political system, finally and painfully passed in 1832. So it wasn't long, but this wasn't a climate that looked favourably on change and innovation in the nation's institutions, like the universities. At this point, no university had been founded in the British Isles for over 200 years. Of the only 8 foundations in existence, 5 were founded before the Reformation, the last of those in 1593. 1 was in Ireland, 4 were in Scotland, or 5, depending on how you count them, and Wales had no university at all. Despite having a population many times more than that of Scotland, just 2 of them were in England and both founded in the Middle Ages. Just over 2% of the Scottish population studied at the university, and I think something less than 1% in the rest of the United Kingdom. They were all male, the idea of university education for women barely yet on the horizon. But a new English middle class had emerged. It had money, got through industry, new industries and manufacturing, but not enough to pay for a university education. And none of the political power and social connections that were so vital in making your way in life at that time. And if its young men were unfortunate enough not to be what we anachronistically call Anglican, they were excluded anyway from the university. Because at Oxford and Cambridge, you had to be a member of the Church of England, at least if you wanted to take a degree. Catholics had been permitted recently to get a degree at Trinity College, Cambridge, Dublin, but couldn't be not Cambridge, but couldn't be awarded prizes or hold any offices. And only in Scotland, surprisingly maybe to some, there were no religious bars or tests for the students at least. That wasn't true for the staff. So this meant for the growing proportion of England's population that wasn't part of the established church going elsewhere for higher education. Previously, many had gone to, if you had the resources, you could go to Germany or the Low Countries. But this was disturbed or closed by the events of the French Revolution, the terror and the war that followed it. So in England, this left only the dissenting academies, which were founded for Baptists and other nonconformists, but they weren't universities and couldn't award a degree. Or you go to Scotland, and many did. So this was the gap that this plan for a new university in and for London addressed. In 1820, the poet Thomas Campbell made a visit, his second visit, to Germany, and he was very impressed by what he saw at the universities that were recently founded in Berlin and Bonn. They had a liberal atmosphere, he saw mutual toleration, even friendship, between Jews, Catholics, Protestants, and was very impressed by the good discipline and behaviour of the students. And I think he was also encouraged by the programme for the University of Virginia, which had been put together by Thomas Jefferson in 1818 and had just recently been published in London. This is known as the Rockfish Gap Report. And its programme is very similar to the one that the University of London put forth in a couple of years. It was also known to the radical Unitarian minister James Yate, who was writing, just about to publish, his thoughts on the advancement of academical education in England, which is a more thoroughly worked out scheme than Campbell's, which was a bit sketchy, and was in its turn influenced by a Scottish lawyer John Russell, who had again travelled through Germany and was in and Austria, and was very impressed by what he'd seen of the liberal education there. And Yeats was so impressed that although he was qualified himself, he took himself off to Berlin to study ancient philology. And then there was Campbell's own education. Like so many of those who came to support the scheme and got involved, Campbell was, well, he was Scottish. He was educated in Scotland at a university in Glasgow, which accepted students regardless of their religious background. They were able to study, besides classics and mathematics, which you could easily get at Oxford, political economy, chemistry, natural and moral philosophy, and law and education that would actually qualify you to practice. And they lived at home with their parents or in lodgings in town. And that sounds familiar to us at UCL. On his return to London, he discussed the possibility of a university that was modelled on what he'd seen in Germany, with the Jewish financier Isaac Lyon Goldsmith, who became the first Jewish baronet. And he welcomed this plan. They seized on it and put him in touch with Henry Broom, who was he wasn't yet Lord Chancellor, he soon would be, but he was a very influential member of Parliament. He had made his name as a flashy kind of lawyer, particularly in the divorce trial of Queen Caroline. And this got the ball rolling really quickly. There was a preliminary meeting in April 1825. There was a prospectus in July. The land for this building was purchased in September. Council elected in December, and then on the 11th of February 1826, our first foundation document, the deed of settlement, was signed. And then after that, there was the laying of the foundation stone in 1827, and the students arrived in October 1828. So 3.5 years. And all this ultimately happened because of a letter that Campbell wrote to the Times in 1835 on this day, the 9th of February, ostensibly to Broom. "The plan which I suggest is a great London university, not a place for lecturing to people of both sexes, except as an appendage to the establishment, but for effectively and multifariously teaching, examining, exercising and rewarding with honours in the liberal arts and sciences the youth of our middling rich people between the ages of 15 and 16 and 20, or later if you please. By the middling rich, I mean all between mechanics and the enormously rich." The implication, I suppose, is that the mechanics institutes that were starting to appear all over the country, they would do for the working man, and Oxbridge would take care of the enormously rich. Others before Campbell, in the 17th and 18th centuries, had from time to time mooted the idea of a university for London, including Daniel Defoe. Nothing ever happened, really. And it was Campbell who saw, I think, and I do plug Campbell a lot here, he saw the conditions were right. He put together a coalition of atheists and religionists and Christians and non-Christians who had the influence and at least some of the money to get this going, to make it happen, and exposed himself to a lot of ridicule and abuse, the disdain of the Times itself, where he published his letter, who said the scheme was crude in conception and meagre in development. But he did devise this scheme. When you look at members of UCL's first council, his coalition, you'd have to say they were almost to a man, and they were all men, of a certain type. The majority were, and I was quite surprised by this, more than not were members of Parliament, about 18 of, out of 25, depending again how you count them. They were mostly Whigs, keen to see reform, even radical reform, some of them. They were members of the very Whiggish Holland House set that gathered around Lord and Lady Holland, and it was the closest thing probably that this country had to a continental salon, and lots of them friends of Bentham, which incidentally is a relationship that goes both ways. Bentham influenced but also was influenced by his friends, including his UCL friends. They were mostly moneyed. Many of them were gentry or nobility, including the Catholic Duke of Norfolk, public school educated, quite a lot at Eton. highly influential and active in public life, with an interest in philanthropy and reform that would be needed to get this university off the ground. Builders of chapels, builders of bridges, and lots of engineering stuff that was making the Industrial Revolution a reality. On the other hand, Anglicans among them were actually in a minority. Many of them had gone to university in Scotland as a consequence, or in one case, the Bristol Baptist Academy, the Baptist minister, F.A. Cox. And this did, of course, influence how they shaped UCL. Many would go on to high office. Lord John Russell earned to the highest of all when he became Prime Minister in the 1840s. Henry Broome, to go back to him, he was the son of a Cumbrian landowner, but he was born and educated in Edinburgh. He'd made his name already, as I said. He was a passionate campaigner for the abolition of slavery and other reforms. But it was this interest in changing the way the people were educated and bringing real education and reform to the generality of the population that encouraged Goldsmith to put him together with Campbell. Although he didn't believe in compulsory education, maybe that was a bit too far for him. Stephen Lushington, also an MP, he was a supporter of all sorts of radical causes, full rights for Jews, dissenters and Catholics, abolishing the death penalty, recognition of the new states in South America that were coming out of colonialism, abolition of slavery. And he was also, like lots of members of the First Council, a founding member of the Society for the Diffusion of Useful Knowledge, whose archives we hold at UCL. It was founded by Broome principally to make available to publish cheap editions of improving works for working people, not the middling rich, probably. George Birkbeck, he's mostly known today for, if I've got the direction right, what's now Birkbeck, down just across the road from us, which is founded as the London Mechanics Institute. He was a Quaker from Yorkshire, so excluded from Oxbridge, but trained as a doctor in Edinburgh and moved to Glasgow after that to teach at the fairly recently founded Andersonian Institution, which had been founded again for useful learning, a real emphasis on useful learning. And it's striking, I've mentioned slavery, lots of these members of the First Council were members or office holders in the anti-slavery society. Emancipation, again, like reform and Catholic emancipation, was just around the corner. But we also should acknowledge that some of those members benefited from slavery. Alexander Baring, of the famous Baring family, had a share in compensation amounting to about £7,000 for over 400 enslaved people when slavery was abolished. And Viscount Dudley and Ward was the owner or part owner of 665 enslaved people in three estates that he inherited from his grandmother, valued at almost £13,000, and there were others. So UCL's birthday is usually counted as the 11th of February 1826, when the deed of settlement was signed. The object was stated there to be the advancement and promotion of literature and science by affording young men adequate opportunities for obtaining literary and scientific education at a moderate expense. It was going to be a joint stock company with shareholders. And so they sold shares at £100 a pop to proprietors. And they elected the council at annual general meeting. And the subjects to be taught, quite new, they were to be arranged under three heads. Firstly, those that were deemed essential for a liberal education, classics, English, French, history, chemistry. Second, those that were considered light or ornamental, German, botany, zoology, Italian, quite a mixed bag. And then third, those that were needed for professional education, so to train and qualify in law and medicine. This was, I think I mentioned before, one of UCL's big innovations. At that time, it wasn't possible to go to the universities and qualify, actually to go out there and be a lawyer or a doctor. UCL put forth statement in 1827 with its programme. And it puts it this way: about 100 only of the physicians now practising in England have been educated at Oxford and Cambridge. There are now 6,000 members of the College of Surgeons, not six of whom have graduated at our universities. And among those who belong to that most important branch of the legal profession, the attorneys, it is believed that scarcely one in 1,000 has had the benefit of a university education. I don't know yet how accurate those figures are, but the picture they paint definitely is. Professors were appointed. They were to be paid a modest salary for 3 years only, and after that they were to depend on fees from the students. So as well as registers of students here, we have what are known as professors' fees books, because they were really important for tracking how much cash you got per student as a teacher. That situation lasted quite a long time. Our fees books go up until about 1920, but the importance of the fees did dwindle. And then, as in Scotland and Germany, and very much not like Oxford and Cambridge, students would not live on the premises, which meant the fees really could be set at a comparatively modest level. This also helped the kind of mocking propaganda that appeared, for example, in John Bull magazine, where it was claimed, "Each dustman shall speak both in Latin and Greek, and tinkers beat bishops in knowledge, if the opulent tribe will consent to subscribe to build up a new Cockney college." By comparison with Oxbridge, though, it's true that the new university was cheap. The average cost for a student who was nominated by a proprietor was £22, 7 shillings and sixpence, whereas even the poorest of the students in Oxford and Cambridge would need about, or at least £40, as well as there were college service charges, and they would need private tutors and so on. What doesn't appear in the curriculum, an area which Campbell deliberately, quietly avoided in his letter to the Times, was religion. Which brings me back to this supposed opposition to the principled opposition that you're supposed to have through the teaching of theology or any kind of promotion of the study of religion. In fact, the plan was to have professors of theology at UCL. There was even a proposal to have a declaration that nothing contrary to revealed religion should be allowed in the instructions in the proposed university or college. But it did prove impossible to reconcile that principle that there would be no religious tests or barriers, and then also teach theology to the satisfaction of Jews, Catholics, Quakers, Baptists. It just couldn't be done. Instead, the spiritual and moral welfare of the young men who didn't live at home, so they would be relying on their parents to keep them on the straight and narrow, they were to be kept by boarding housekeepers with satisfactory religious habits and morals, who, among other things, would have to ensure their charges attended regular public worship. In other words, it was a last-ditch compromise designed to keep everyone on board. So who were those students and where did they come from? Well, I wanted to see what the university had to say, looking at the council and its correspondence, whether there is anything remarkable about the students, or about individuals, about groups. So I looked at the first council minutes, and that's the very first page of the minutes. It's a bit done something to it. And I've been using some fairly new text recognition software, which is very exciting, called Transcribus, which is designed to be trainable, if that's a word, to read and transcribe handwritten text, but it really does speed up the process, and that's what it does. And I've looked at student registers as well, which helpfully have a column for the student's place of origin, and you see here our very first Japanese students who came in the 1860s. And to put them into a context, I've looked at available records of other institutions to see, for example, where their students were coming from at this time, their ages, background, and so on. So I started with Alumni Oxonienses, which publishes the names and some information about students who went to Oxford, just looking at the 1820s and 30s, see where they came from. And of those hundreds, 15 came from out with England, and that's 85% were from England, which, when you look at UCL's registers, is exactly the percentage of UCL students who came from England in its first 3 years, over a quarter from London alone. So that's similar, but what's different in UCL's case is where that 15% were coming from, whereas the Oxford ones were coming from other parts of the British Isles, mostly. It turns out in UCL they came from much farther afield, so I mapped that. And that's just the first year, which did surprise me. As we might expect, those people coming from places like the Caribbean and the East Indies were from British colonial families. Some were sons of slave owners or officers serving with the East India Company. But before long, Indian students were coming to UCL, for example, study medicine. Among them, a man named Surjo Kumar Chakrabarty, there he is, who was awarded the gold medal for comparative anatomy. Moses Roper, he came from North Carolina. He was a slave. His father was his mother's owner. He escaped slavery, came to England, and registered at UCL in 1839. And he wrote one of the earliest American slave narratives. Samuel Lewis, he came from Sierra Leone, studied law here, and later he was the Chief Justice of his country, and he was the first African to be knighted. John Carr was also from Sierra Leone. He was the son of an unknown black woman, possibly also enslaved, and a white Englishman. He was the first black law student at UCL, and he was the first Chief Justice and acting governor of his country. He was also, with his brother, a beneficiary through his father of the government's slavery compensation scheme for an estate in Trinidad. And then I mentioned, going back to the registers there, there were some Japanese students who came to UCL when it was still illegal. It was punishable by death to leave. They were smuggled out. And they supplied Japan with its very first prime minister. Disappointingly, the minutes, on the other hand, don't have much to say about the students, actually, apart from what they were going to charge them. But that's maybe not so surprising. The council was a bit busy fighting its enemies, recruiting professors, and worrying about the building, to worry about what kinds of people the students would be. So how true is our claim? How egalitarian was our foundation? Well, if you were keeping a score sheet against those criteria that I was talking about, that we were the first English university to admit students regardless of race, class, religion, gender, you'd have to say one race. No, we know that Alexander Crummell, who was the son of an American slave, studied at Cambridge in the middle of the 18th century, and no United Kingdom university discriminated against students, not explicitly, on grounds of race. So in that way, UCL wasn't so different. Class, yes and no. There were no barriers in terms of class, that's true, except in the sense of having the money to pay. UCL was cheaper. But you could say that about Oxbridge. There were no barriers. If you were Anglican and you could pay, you could come. And as in Oxbridge, money topped at UCL, just like anywhere else. So if you bought more shares, you had more voting rights. And if a student was nominated by a proprietor, you got a discount. So connections did help there, just like anywhere else. So to that extent, I think Campbell's middling rich does hit the nail on the head. Religion, though, I think definitely is a revolution at UCL. But it was partly because the men who were shaping this place cared deeply about faith and the religious and moral well-being of their charges. It wasn't an anti-religious stance, not for most of them. And gender, well, I know I'm not really here to talk about that, but I'm going to anyway, just a little bit. It is a different story. But I would like to say the answer against that criterion would be yes, but it's complicated. UCL was the first to admit women to degrees, 50 years after we were founded, but not yet on equal terms. And that's something maybe that isn't quite so widely acknowledged. Women were refused admission to the debating society, to the students' union, so they formed their own, and they were discriminated against by means of what's called the passing in rule. And that was in force until the 1918-19 session, which said no woman, unless she is the wife or daughter of the provost or of a professor, is admitted as a student of the college, except upon an introduction or reference which the lady superintendent may deem satisfactory. There was an extra hurdle there for ladies. So we shouldn't kid ourselves that UCL opened education to all. That just wasn't true. And I think we do ourselves a disservice if we buy too much into the godless and Cockney University image, because we would be ignoring the fact that this was crude propaganda whose aim was to strangle this place at or before birth. We deny an important part of our identity when we forget or choose to forget, on the one hand, that some of our founders were motivated by deep religious convictions, and on the other hand, that some of them benefited from slavery. But I think the truth is richer and more interesting than the myths. UCL did make university education affordable and attainable to a much more representative section of society. And those people, I think, tended to be the doers, engineers, lawyers, doctors, makers even, we talk about makers, who shaped the world around them, and I mean this in both senses, for good.
Thank you very much indeed, Colin. We do have time for questions if anyone's got one. And if you do have a question, you just wait for the microphone to come to you so people watching at home can hear. Does anyone have a question? Do you have any questions? Someone to sit?
Yeah, I'm always nosy, Colin. I want to know, what are you researching next?
More of this, I hope. I've just been looking at the foundation, but I'd like to take forward some of the work I've been doing with transcribers, which I mentioned. First we have to digitise more of the minutes, so it's a practical thing, and that's in the plan. Doing more digging, because this is just scratching the surface, really. Scotching the myths.
There's a question in the middle.
You said that fees became less important as time went on. I'm just wondering how the university was financed after that. And also, did the university pay a dividend to its shareholders?
No. That one first. The plan was, because it was a joint stock company, that there would be a return, but there never was. There was never enough money. The Wilkins Building is quite a grandiose thing. I think it's fair to say that they went forward with that, a massive financial risk. In order to combat some of the Cockney University propaganda, they needed to look substantial rather than doing what James Yates wanted, which is to be very modest, live in some townhouses in Bloomsbury. So that kind of got UCL into a bit of financial trouble, and it was never really able to return on those shares. I've forgotten your first question. Yes.
Fees became less important, so how was the university financed when they became less important?
Well, first of all, it really was through the shares, and as I said, that was a struggle. But when UCL, and I didn't mention this because I really was focusing on the foundation, but UCL was called the University of London for its first 10 years. Then King's was set up as a reaction, so we have us to thank for their foundation. But then they were both put together in what became the University of London in 1836. And from then, the government took a lot of control and really bailed out both institutions because they did struggle. I think what saved UCL was, and again, I didn't mention it, the medical school and the school. We had a school for boys after the first, from 1832 to 1833. And that brought in lots of money, and that really kept things going. that's like they just brought in more fees and occasionally increased the fees over time, and that just kept things going.
Hello. This is a question from me. I normally ask them on behalf of Slido. It was interesting how quickly it all happened from sort of the inception to getting the building. What was this area like then that you could just purchase a piece of land in Bloomsbury and just make it happen?
Well, it had just been open from, I think, from about 1800s by the Duke of Bedford, who still owns most of Bloomsbury, I think. And you can see a nice apology thing on Russell Square, can't you, on a SOAS building, for building something without their permission. Which always amuses me. Sorry. It was just starting to be developed. There were market gardens around from Queen Square over that way near Russell Square station. When that was built, the north side was left empty so that the people could have unimpeded views up to Hampstead. So there's very little around. The Wilkins building now sits on where it was really just a rubbish tip. It was a bit of a bog, really. But lots of the squares and streets were being built around.
We probably have time for one more question if there is one. But if not, I want to thank. Oh, there's one here. Thanks.
You talked about the geographical origins of the first group of students. Do we have any records of their religious affiliations or not?
No, you didn't mention that. Really disappointingly, the first register, I don't have an image with me, the first register does. There's a little abbreviation under everyone's name. But they gave up doing that after about 18 or 20 students, not really. They gave up doing that because it was really interesting. So under Robert Browning, the poet, Robert Browning, he was here in the very first session. He didn't last. There is a letter D under his name for dissenter, and that's why he came here. I think his mother was very religious. And I think there is only one who's marked as Roman Catholic and one who's marked as Jewish. And the rest are dissenter or CH for church. It's really disappointing. That would make my job a lot easier. Because now, if you really want to know about some of the students in those registers, I have to go and look for them in the DNB and whatever else.
Just in under the wire, we have got a question from Slido. So I'm going to pass back to Emma.
It came in very quickly. Question is, what do you think about the current image of UCL as a progressive institution, and what role does it have in contemporary history?
Oh, contemporary history, I don't know anything about it. So I'm going to duck slightly out of that. I think, but just speaking part, you know, this is my opinion. It's no more valid than anyone else's, I think. But I do think it's well deserved. We are a progressive institution. We always have been. But I just want to tell a bit more of the truth of that, that it's more complicated. This place was hated by a lot of the establishment. I'm not casting any sort of stones, but Oxford and Cambridge fought a furious campaign, particularly to stop UCL being able to train doctors, because it was money for them. It was a real threat to them. We have the first ever chair of geography in this country, first chair in lots of things. It was the first place you could study for lots of new subjects. And I think we've got an awful lot to be proud of, as well as, you know, we know the negatives about UCL. But those positive things, I think, are worth celebrating.
What a great place to end. I want to thank you all for coming. Thank you for your questions, but thank you mostly to Colin Penman. Thanks.